Next is 14th K.M.Bashir Memorial Lecture. Dr. M.S. Valiathan sir will deliver that memorial lecture now. I request Dr. Valiathan.
Professor Damodaran, Engineer A.Suhair, Dr. Yunus, Dr. John Samuel, Professor Abdul Majid, Dr. Achyut Shankar, distinguished guests and friends. In many ways, I am privileged this morning to be here. In the first place, I am privileged to be in Trivandrum. This is where I studied my college, my karma bhumi, after so many years, to come back to Trivandrum. That is always a privilege. Secondly, you have heard about Vakkom Moulavi, one of the great social reformers. It is difficult for us to imagine the kind of challenges they face of Sarajavi and Damashamala in early years of the 20th century, to salute him and take part in a function of the trust bearing his name. And I had the great pleasure to know Sri Bashir. He used to come to Trivandrum from his Geneva assignment. And I had met him in the company of P.K. Gopalakrishnan sometimes. Once we had a meeting with Elema George and another fellow statistician and Professor Samuel Mathai. So he could, apart from his scholarship, interest in social issues, he could add to the richness of cultural life in Trivandrum. So I always remember him, and you have heard about his passing away under tragic circumstances. So it is a great privilege to give a lecture in his memory today. Professor Karim was well known to me. He was also a scholar, an activist, an educationist, and a good friend, always radiating warmth wherever and whenever he went. So to give an award in his name to Dr. Achyut Shankar, a mini splendid personality, you will hear more about him, formal introduction, a PhD in engineering, a PhD in music, a humanist, and in many ways a splendid personality. So I have great privilege to hand over this award to him, and a blessed company like all of you here. So in many ways I am privileged to be here. The subject which I have chosen is social audit of science, which would have been of great interest to Sri Bashir and even Vakkom Moulavi. There is social audit. That is not a new term, because social audit has been done for a very long time. And on searching the literature, I found the first social audit of industry was done by Tata Iron and Steel Company in this country. You will be surprised to hear this. The social audit in a remote place of Bihar, starting this steel factory, the social impact of this. This was one of the first earliest studies done in India. So it has been done in many other areas. Even Government of India has many social, ICSSR conducts various surveys. But we are essentially interested in the social audit of science. That is the subject I have chosen, which I think would have been of interest to Professor Karim, to all of you sitting here. Now, social audit of science is a rather new subject in India. We have various departments of the government, whether it is agriculture, DST, atomic energy, they all publish their annual reports, but these are not audit. They are simply annual reports, usually self-congratulatory. But that is not what I am talking about. Social audit of the science, I think the real credit should go to the United States. The National Science Board, which was set up some 60 years ago, when such a thing did not exist, I don't know about the Soviet Union and so on, but in the Western world, that was undoubtedly the pioneering effort. And the National Science Board is the parent of National Science Foundation, which many of you would have heard. All the science funding for research is done by NSF. Not only in the United States, even internationally, they give a lot of assistance. Now, that National Science Foundation, its agenda is set by the National Science Board. Now, National Science Board consists of very eminent people, some 15 members, and it reports directly to the U.S. Congress and to the U.S. President. And they have set up an institute mainly for statistics, which Sri Bashir would have loved it to work there. Everything is based on quantification, numbers, and they produce extensive reports every alternate year. They come out with this National Science Board reports. Now that sets the agenda for science and technology in the United States. Initially, they never used to give any recommendations, policies. That was left to the Congress. So it's directly reporting to the Parliament there. Later on, a few years ago, they started giving some policy views also. That is subsequent, an annexure. It was not there earlier. Now that, I think the, when I first saw these reports a few years ago, I was very much impressed, because you can at once see it covers, they have five subcommittees. One of them is education, including science education. Another is SMT. So there you begin to realize some certain areas were weak. For example, a few years ago in the United States, they found from this report that mathematics education is becoming weak. Research is not adequate. Number of PhDs is not adequate. Number of students wanting to take mathematics is not adequate. Once this comes out, immediately action is taken to strengthen teaching of mathematics. So it is a direct impact on policy. I wished something like that would happen here. I had thought about it, but there was no agency doing that in India. So when I became president of the Indian National Science Academy in 2002, I thought the academy would be the right place to do this. It is government funded, but it is completely autonomous. There is very high credibility for that academy. But then I discovered who would do this assessment. Because National Science Board consists of statisticians, very large number of them. They are economists, sociologists. It's a very highly scholarly group, multidisciplinary. And there was no such organization here I could think of. I first contacted Professor K.N. Raj, who was a good friend of mine, and also of Bashir. Raj told me, well, you know, you forget it, we cannot do that here. We don't have that kind of talent here. And the Indian Statistical Institute, Calcutta, the director, Ghosh, she was a member of our council, so I asked him. He said, the statistical part we can do, the Mahalanobis group is still there. But when you talk about the social impact and all that, we cannot do that. So like this, I went on asking various people. Finally, I ended up with Dr. Manmohan Singh, who was at that time leader of opposition in Rajya Sabha. He's not only a noted economist, a very wise person. So I approached him and asked him. He said, I know exactly what you're talking about, but give me a few days to think about it. It's not easy to find people to do this. Then after a few days, I got a fax from him. The National Council for Applied Economic Research in Delhi, NCIR, they would be the right people. I have talked to them, they are interested in this. So I met Professor Suman Biri, the director, and he said that they had done various types of surveys, including social impact in African countries, many places. They have a great reputation, especially the sample surveys and so on. But we have not done this in the area of science, but we would like to try it. That was the start. But they wanted a feasibility study, whether it can be done at all in India. So our academy was doing the funding. And the feasibility study took 4 months. And then they came and told us, it's very revealing. First of all, the data is so scattered in India. Institutions, universities, number of different places you've got to keep on collecting data. That is one difficulty. Second, there is great reluctance in parting with data. People are not open. There is secrecy everywhere. Why should a UGC, for example, why cannot everything be in the public domain? There is great reluctance parting with data. So like that, they said, and then the quality of data. Suppose you want to know the number of PhDs produced in engineering. You get that information from AICTE. You get the information from UGC. You get the collective information from the universities who give the degrees. They don't match. So there are problems like that, quality of data. So they told us we have very severe difficulties in doing this, but we agree the start should be made. And out of many, many things you can measure, for example, you can look at science education, you can look at human assets, people trained, etc. That is another way of measuring number of patents, the socio-economic impact of doing science, number of things. We cannot do all this. So we will select only three areas. One is science education. The other is the human resources in science and technology. And thirdly, we will look at public understanding of science. You hear so much about scientific temper. Now that is something which is measurable. So public understanding of science. Only these three things we will do. All the others we cannot. But if this report continues, what we call India Science Report, every 2 years, then over a period of time, people become aware of the quality of data, how to be open with the data, the importance of this analysis. Then slowly we can build up something like a National Science Board here. This was our idea. They did that study over a period of 2.5 years. It was released by Dr. Manmohan Singh, and it came out with very, very interesting information about the school education. For example, you would find children at the age of, say, in the 8th standard, almost 40% of them are greatly interested in doing science. But 12th standard, when you repeat this study, that interest has dropped to 20%. Now, what happens? Why is it at the 8th standard they are so keen on science, a large percentage? By 12th standard, this interest has declined. Now, here is a very important observation based on data. Like that, number of interesting findings, including public understanding. We always think common people, they don't know science. But actually in the survey you find many of them understand a lot of science. What we think illiterate people, they have given all that. These are very large numbers, 75,000 people selected all over India. So the sample selection is unquestionable. But there you will find even the, we think an illiterate person, he understands something about the earth rotating, about plants growing. It's quite surprising, the common people and their faith in science. Even though they don't take science, there is a great deal, almost 60% I think, they believe science can solve the problems of India. That's a very big understanding of science. So it's a very useful, very good study. Now this particular kind of social audit of science, there are many, many indices. This has very great importance because the science, what we call the fundamental sciences, where you look at exploration of the unknown, transcending utility, that kind of science is very important, like Srinivasa Ramanujan doing mathematics, or Chandrasekhar looking at astronomy. Now that kind of science, we are not looking in terms of utility. That is absolutely necessary. That is where the human mind blooms. We should encourage it, a good educational system. But that alone is not enough. That utilitarian science is also important because that is what makes a difference to our daily life. Now this is the crucial thing. When you talk about social audit, we are really asking questions like, has this science you are doing, has it created jobs? Has it created better shelter for us? Has it provided us clean water? Has it provided us food? Has it ensured the quality of food? Has it gotten rid of the drudgery of daily life in the countryside, etc., etc. Has it made the country strong in terms of defense? Number of these questions. Now those are the socially important issues. Now that is what a social audit should do. So when we are doing this science transcending utility, there should always be this break should be there. Now if you don't do that, the consequences can be dreadful. And I'll give you just one example from our own medical history in India. You all would have heard about Sushruta. Sushruta lived perhaps a century ahead of the Buddha. Lived in Banaras. His book is a classic. You read all the surgical procedures done in those days. 120 type of instruments, 20 sharp instruments, 100 blunt instruments, proctoscopes. These are all described. You can read it. Measurements are given. They should be fabricated by highly skilled craftsmen. They were greatly respected. How they should be stored, everything is there. So surgeons were highly respected. And surgery in the 8 divisions of Ayurveda, the very first is Shalya surgery. That was the kind of reputation it had. But some 800 years later, by 3rd century of the current era, these are all changed. Surgeons were no longer respected. None of these procedures described, they were done by Ayurvedic Vaidyas. Not one of them. Like for example, fracture setting. This was all done in Sushruta's time, there's a whole chapter. But no fracture would be set by Ayurvedic physicians. Urinary stones being removed, a very complex operation. No Ayurvedic physician would do it. cataract being done. Susruta describes it. Couching for a cataract. There is a whole chapter. No Ayurvedic physician would do it. Ayurvedic physicians would only do the theory, vaidyas, medicines being given. Now, who were doing all this? They were being done here and there on the fringes of the society. But these were all people called lower castes. Suddenly, this transformation over a period of 800 years, what was highly prized and respected, they were all downgraded. In fact, there are many examples. In the 19th century, for example, we have no records of these. For example, Susruta Samhita, which is an old text, where these operations are described. But nobody had ever seen it. It could be like something described in our epics. Never existed. Nobody, there is no record. But until the British came here in the 19th century, that is before the British had conquered India, there was a phase between 1750 to 1820, that period. They themselves did not know that they would conquer India. They were probing here and there our weaknesses, how they could get good commercial deals. This is what they were looking for. But they also looked at the sources of native knowledge. And there were one time, 1820, around that time, there were 10 fellows of the Royal Society here, living in India 5 years, 10 years, looking at the knowledge practices of the natives. This is what they called. They recorded in Pune a man doing this rhinoplasty. It's a detailed report, including diagrams. Two surgeons watched it. And this was being done by a man who belonged to what is called Kumar caste, which I asked my Maharashtrian friends, they are the potters. Only they would do this operation. There was another caste in different parts of India who would do the fracture setting. They are not Ayurvedic physicians. They are people who are denied education, lower castes, but through generations, tradition, they have learned the skill. They're highly skillful people. Couching for cataract in Coimbatore district, there is a very good description how a man would come and do this. And this was done by Mohammedans and a lower caste, some name is there. It is written there. Only they would do this operation. When the operation was done, a small crowd would collect there. It was called couching, not removing the lens. It is simply displacing the opaque lens. That is the old procedure. That was being done. But all these, number of procedures like this, you can read the British descriptions. From that we realize, during these centuries, the theory was exalted. So-called science which transcends utility. Now that exaltation of that and the denigration of what is useful, that we paid a heavy price for it. I think there is some commotion going on here. I hope it is not the election problem. So I think therefore, this particular change which took place over a period of hundreds of years, now that is really what this is all about. In fact, about that event, P.C. Ray, some of you may have heard, he was one of the great products of the Indian Renaissance, early part of the 20th century when Western science came to India, mainly Presidency College, Calcutta. There were some brilliant students. The first products of this interaction, East-West Encounter, J.C. Bose, P.C. Ray was one of them in chemistry. P.C. Ray wrote a very great classic history of chemistry in India. More than 100 years ago, it's a classic. Anybody interested in the growth of science in India must read that book. Brilliantly written. And about this phase, he says, the inductive and experimental science died in India. The spirit of inquiry vanished, and India's name was all but expunged from the map of natural science. Something like that, he writes. And he adds, and the soil of India became morally unfit for the birth of a Newton or a Boyle. This is what he writes. I'm quoting from memory. That's what happens. If you have only this theory, what you consider fundamental, and you don't look at all these utilitarian things, they are looked down upon. Now, don't think this has disappeared. Even today, that attitude persists. We don't realize it, because I can tell you from my own experience, before I came to Chitra Institute, I had come back from the United States. I was interested in making a heart valve, which I knew could be done here. Of course, it cannot be done in a hospital. You need a top-class engineering place. So I worked for a year as a professor in the IIT Madras. Unusual thing for a surgeon to do. I was operating in the railway hospital 3 days. Rest of the time, I was in the IIT. But in the IIT, I was taking classes, seminars, all that. But after 2 or 3 months, I talked to the professor there, a professor in charge, head of the department. I would like to make this. In fact, not a valve, it was a ring to make a loose valve competent. It is an unconventional ring, cannot be easily made. But in the IIT, the workshop is such, it could be made. So when I explained all this and how important it is, because in India, rheumatic valvular heart disease is common, more common among women, and once they get this disease, they become progressively disabled, eventually ending up in valve replacement, families often break up. It is a huge problem. And if this could be done, many years of healthy life could be guaranteed. So this professor's response, I still remember, he said, you know, Dr. Valiathan, this is interesting, but, you know, this is actually a gadget. You know, how can an IIT get into this gadget? This was the reaction. Now, this is exactly what happened. Hundreds of years ago, we started looking down on these. This is gadget. What is it that you do? You do a theoretical modeling of the valve. You take 3 years, produce a PhD, a thesis. Finite element modeling of the aortic valve. It doesn't help anybody except that candidate who got a PhD. It does not advance science in any way. But this is what we do. So that attitude of exalting what we believe is fundamental. And human suffering is much more fundamental as far as we are concerned. So if you social audit of science, whether it is National Science Board, does it in a scientific way, this is what it does. A social audit makes you aware of the significance of what you are doing. Now, if you pay attention to that, then science will become relevant, it will become important, and we will all collectively do much better. In the United States, for example, we always say, oh, they are very materialistic. But the fact is, you take the world's number one university, MIT, it is not Harvard, it is in the same place. But MIT, they pay equal attention to this. Nobel Prizes, there are several people doing this fundamental blue sky research, as they say, stretching the human mind to the very limits of its capacity. That they do. But they have so many technologies which transforming the lives of people, not only there, even today, for example, we all hear about frugal technology. Now that's the buzzword. Frugal technology, really what it is state-of-the-art technology. It is not cheap. That state-of-the-art technology for building a house or building a machine or building a heart-lung machine, whatever, state-of-the-art, but it is affordable to the developing countries. Now that is made affordable by using superior intelligence, very high level of science. But it makes it, but this originated, it should have started in India. We are the people who need it. But this was conceptualized and done in MIT Boston. So I think that balance which they have been able to achieve, that is both theory, mind being taken to the limits, but at the same time, keeping your feet solidly on the ground. So what you do is useful for the people. So I hope that message, this is something which what you have heard today repeatedly, the social consciousness of people, that has to be kept preeminently in our mind. And I hope that message will go through the activities of this foundation. So I have great pleasure in greeting all those who are responsible for setting up this trust and also extending my warmest congratulations to Dr. Achyut Shankar. I had the great joy of reading his PhD thesis in music a few days ago. I wrote to him, I read it in one sitting because I had great interest in Swarathirinal's life. And this was the thesis of that subject. So I have very great pleasure, especially by giving this award to him. Thank you.
Now the presentation ceremony will start. Dr. Professor M.S. Valiathan sir will present the award comprising rupees 1 lakh in cash and the memento and the citation to him.